Thanks very much for the invitation to come back to India. In fact, my last intercontinental trip before the pandemic was to India, but to one of your neighboring institutions in Chennai. But I'm particularly glad to be back here at ICTS, where I had a very enjoyable visit a few years ago. So I'm tasked with talking about, it's called physics overview. So I have to apologize, it's going to be essentially a particle physics overview, but of course with elements of cosmology and astrophysics, because the two topics are extremely closely linked. So what I'm going to do is start off just by discussing the status of the Standard Model. Now there's many motivations for physics beyond the Standard Model, which I'll also go through. A lot of these motivations for physics beyond the Standard Model actually arise from the success of the Standard Model with the Higgs boson. The Higgs boson, as I try to convey, is an extremely puzzling particle. So how are we going to look for this new physics? So of course you can look directly for new particles or interactions, or you can look indirectly. And a technique which is very promising in my view at the present time is the idea of effective field theory, where you look for low energy manifestations of the physics, which may eventually appear at higher energies. Now, we shouldn't forget, of course, that actually there are some experimental anomalies in the present data. I'm not going to go through all of them, but I just want to mention at least two, namely the value of the W mass, which was recently reported by the CDF collaboration, and the anomalous magnetic moment of the muon. It seems that Fermilab kind of has a monopoly on producing interesting anomalies at the present time. And as I promised, I'll say a little bit towards the end about astrophysics and cosmology, in particular, the origin of the matter in the universe and the dark matter. Okay, so here is the Standard Model, which can be written in a form simple enough either to appear on one slide or to appear on one t-shirt. So on the t-shirt, you write down four lines. So the first line describes the gauge interactions, the fundamental interactions between the elementary particles. The second line describes how those various different interactions work upon fundamental fermions, electrons, quarks, and so on. And those two lines, of course, were tested to better than the 0.1% level by experiments at LEP and Fermilab before the LHC got started. And many of you in the audience were involved in those studies. In particular, a very strong team from India was involved in those LEP experiments. So the third and fourth lines describe the interactions of the Higgs boson, which has been at the center of particle physics probably for the last 10 or 20 years. So the third line describes how the Higgs boson is supposed to give masses to fundamental fermions through Yukawa interactions. And the bottom line carries in a somewhat concealed way the mechanism for giving masses to the weak vector bosons and the effective Higgs potential, which stabilizes the whole system. So of course, before 2012, we didn't know directly anything at all about those two bottom lines. And those two bottom lines are the ones that we've been testing over the last 10 years. And that story will undoubtedly continue into the future. So, so this guy here has a lot to answer for. The particle that he produced is a reflection of a mechanism which plays a central role in the construction of the Standard Model. But as I've already mentioned, and I'm going to emphasize this point, this particle is very puzzling. This mechanism is extremely puzzling, and it provides many of the motivations for thinking there should be physics beyond the Standard Model. So I have to confess, my long-standing involvement with the Higgs boson. In fact, back in 1975, when the first real evidence for gauge theories started to emerge, you know, many people were thinking about looking for the W boson or the Z boson. But it seemed to us at the time that the key issue was the Higgs boson. And so we wrote this phenomenological profile paper back at the end of 1975. Of course, in those days, these ideas were regarded as being extremely speculative, and the distinguished gray-haired professors sitting in the front row would shake their heads if you talked about the Higgs boson. And that was one of the reasons why we wrote this infamous sentence at the end of our paper: we don't want to encourage big experimental searches for the Higgs boson. But fortunately, our experimental colleagues, our accelerator colleagues, ignored that rather poor advice. And this is what our experimental and accelerator colleagues have come up with over the past 10 years since the discovery of the Higgs boson. So this is a compendium of standard model measurements involving the W boson, Z boson, top quark, and of course, the Higgs boson. And as you can see here, all these measurements agree within uncertainties with the predictions of the standard model, which is, on one hand, a great thing. The theory works, the experiments work, the accelerators work. On the other hand, it's an extremely bad thing because where are the clues to tell us how to go looking for physics beyond the standard model? And in particular, here you see outlined the fact that there are many measurements of the Higgs boson reduction and decays at the LHC, and they all agree with the standard model prediction. So I just want to emphasize that this work was done not by CERN. It was done by an international collaboration of thousands of physicists working with each other and with CERN. This fantastic human achievement was made possible by global international collaboration. And I would just like to give you one example of that. So these are cartridges from Russian naval shells, which were melted down and converted into components of the CMS detector. A lot of that work was done in Belarus, and it was financed by the United States. This is the sort of international collaboration which made possible the achievements of particle physics and which will make possible our future achievements. Okay, so what do we know about the Higgs boson? So its couplings should scale to other particles proportional to their mass. And this is a compilation of data from the CMS collaboration, which addresses that issue. So along the horizontal axis, we have the particle mass. The vertical axis, we have the coupling to the Higgs boson. And you see that over many orders of magnitude, the couplings of the Higgs are indeed proportional to the particle mass. So as with a student we wrote a few years ago, this particle walks and quacks like a Higgs boson. But this picture is on the one hand a success, and on the other hand, it's a puzzle. What on earth is the origin of the hierarchy of masses and mixings of the fundamental particles? Here we see a hierarchy of masses between 100 MeV and 175 GeV, three orders of magnitude. What explains that ratio? So I want to emphasize that the discovery of the Higgs boson is not the end of a story. In fact, it's the beginning of a story, because the Higgs boson poses us so many puzzles that remain as yet unanswered. And here I'd like to take a quotation from a poem by T.S. Eliot: to make an end is to make a beginning. The end is where we start from. And no, we're now starting on a new journey in particle physics to see what lies beyond the Higgs boson, what lies beyond the standard model. So I take my text for this part of my talk from a film featuring James Bond. I somewhat changed the title from "The World Is Not Enough" to "The Standard Model Is Not Enough." I changed the hero of the film. I also changed the villain. And in deference to James Bond, I give you 007 reasons for thinking there must be physics beyond the Standard Model. Empty space is unstable, according to calculations within the Standard Model. The Standard Model does not explain the dark matter in the universe or the origin of matter in the universe. And as I already mentioned, it doesn't explain the hierarchy of mass scales within the Standard Model and also the overall scale of the Standard Model, the Higgs vacuum expectation value relative to the scale of gravity. So I'm going to try in the rest of this talk to at least discuss briefly the topics in the ovals. And these are all topics which are now being explored by experiments at the LHC. So why do I say that everything about the Higgs is puzzling? So here I've written out the terms in the Standard Model Lagrangian, which involve the Higgs boson. So the first one is the Yukawa coupling. These Yukawa couplings, as I already mentioned, vary over large, many orders of magnitude. There's also the mixing between the quarks in the weak interactions. And we don't have any idea where that hierarchy, where that mixing originate. We can parameterize it, but to have a fundamental theoretical understanding, no. Then the second term here is the Higgs mass term. And as you know, it's crucial that that have a negative sign and that it be relatively small compared with the scale of gravity. Standard Model doesn't provide any explanation for that. And that's what's often goes by the name of the naturalness or hierarchy problem. And I'll come back to that in just a second. Then we've got the quartic self-coupling of the Higgs boson, which is necessary to stabilize the Higgs vacuum expectation value. Now we know indirectly from measurements what the magnitude of that coupling is. And we can calculate its renormalization as you go to high scales. And those calculations within the Standard Model indicate that it goes negative, and that destabilizes the electroweak vacuum, the potential turns down. So some people say, well, we don't particularly care. No, as long as the vacuum lives long enough for us to be here. But I find that a very unsatisfactory philosophical viewpoint. Then we've got the cosmological constant, which I put in here, because that is also it's not surprising that it be non-zero. What's surprising is the magnitude of it, which again is many, many, many orders of magnitude different from what you might expect in a quantum theory of gravity. And in particular, when you switch on the Higgs mechanism, you change the cosmological constant, again, by many orders of magnitude more than the experimental value. A naturalness and hierarchy problem, which if anything, is even more puzzling than the scale of the weak interactions. So as I'll discuss in a moment, it may well be that there are additional interactions involving the Higgs boson, perhaps due to the presence of virtual heavy quantum particles. And I'll come back to that in a moment. So many of you have seen a slide looking like this one on many occasions in the past. It doesn't mean to say that it's no longer a reasonable slide to show. Just reminds you that within the Standard Model, if the Higgs boson is an elementary particle, when you calculate quantum corrections to its mass, you get answers which are infinite, not just logarithmically infinite, like what you have in QED, but quadratically infinite. Now, those can be canceled because the corrections from fermions and bosons have opposite signs. They can be canceled if you have a specific relationship between the scalar and fermion couplings, and that is exactly the relationship which you have in the theory of supersymmetry. And supersymmetry not only guarantees the absence of these quadratic divergences at one loop, but to all orders, 865 loops, supersymmetry tells you, that those quadratic divergences go away. So some people will say, well, I don't care about the divergence. You know, I just fine tune the parameters so that I get the correct physical value of the Higgs mass. I don't find that a reasonable idea. I think that that quadratic divergence is telling us that there is a sensitivity here to ultraviolet physics that we just don't understand. So I've already mentioned the S word, and I'll come back on occasion later in my talk to supersymmetry. It's become a bit unfashionable because supersymmetry hasn't shown up yet at the LHC or in other experiments. But actually, I'm going to be contrarian and argue that the first round of experiments at the LHC has actually given us additional reasons for loving supersymmetry. Supersymmetry can stabilize the electroweak vacuum. It made a successful prediction for the Higgs mass. It made the successful prediction that the couplings of the Higgs should look like those in the standard model. And it could solve the naturalness problem. It plays a role in grand unification, string theory, could provide dark matter, and it could explain the anomaly in the anomalous magnetic moment of the muon. So there's still many reasons to like supersymmetry, many reasons why future experiments should continue to look for it. So let me just say a little bit more about this issue of the stability of the electroweak vacuum. So this is a sort of a somewhat figurative representation of the potential energy as a function of the value of the Higgs field. So here is the non-zero value of the Higgs field, which holds in the present day universe. That's where we are. But calculations within the standard model indicate that there is another state over here with a much larger density of the Higgs field, which would be energetically preferred. Quantum mechanics then tells us that it's inevitable that the theory will fall through into this big crunch configuration under which the universe would collapse, would tunnel through the barrier. So what can you do? Well, what you could do is you could erect an infinite barrier through which you cannot tunnel. And that's exactly what supersymmetry does for you. So there's this issue of the future of the universe and its possible instability. But I would mention also that there's an issue of how we got to this vacuum in the first place, because in a very hot and dense early universe, fluctuations in the Higgs field would have been very large, and calculations show that most of the universe should have finished up in that big crunch state billions of years ago. So I think this is an issue which we need to take seriously. And here on this slide, perhaps I won't go through the details of it, but these are results of numerical calculations within the standard model. This stability issue is linked to the mass of the top quark, the mass of the Higgs boson, and also the strong coupling constant plays an important role. And you put in the current particle data group best fit values, and you find that there's an instability of the electroweak vacuum, which sets in at a scale of about 10 to the 11, 10 to the 12 GeV. And that's illustrated here. So if, for example, the Higgs mass had been larger or the top quark mass had been smaller, it would be in this stable state. But instead, we're sitting here. These are the one standard deviation particle data group values, which indicate that we live in this unstable regime. Okay, so I've given you a tremendous number of reasons for thinking that there might be physics beyond the standard model, presumably associated with heavy particles of some sort. So how are we going to discover that new physics? Well, of course, one thing you can do is go out and look for the new heavy particles, and that's what the LHC is continuing to do and what we're hoping to do with possible future colliders. But you can also look for the indirect effects due to the exchanges of heavy virtual particles. And here I have another quotation from the Chinese strategist Sun Tzu. The direct method may be used, you can look for new particles, but indirect methods will be needed in order to secure victory. Don't forget to look for the virtual exchange effects. The direct and the indirect lead on to each other in turn, which is like moving in a circle. So obviously he had in mind LEP, LHC, and FCC. Who can exhaust the possibilities of their combination? So I'd like to remind you that effective field theories have a glorious history in the establishment of the Standard Model. Back in the 1930s, we had a sort of embryonic piece of the Standard Model, a formulation of quantum electrodynamics with a dimensionless coupling, so a dimension four interaction. But in parallel to that, Fermi had proposed his four Fermi contact interaction for the weak interactions, which has dimension six. Now, there's a lot of discussion about the form of that dimension six interaction. Was it scalar, pseudoscalar, vector, axial, maybe even tensor? But there's a general feeling that it wasn't a fundamental theory, that this dimension six interaction was generated by the exchanges of massive particles. In the 1950s, it emerged that this interaction had the form of a V minus A current-current interaction. So everybody said, well, there must be massive vector bosons to mediate that interaction. So of course, that then led on to the formulation of gauge theories with spontaneous symmetry breaking a la Higgs. Also, in the strong interactions, Yukawa in the 1930s proposed his that the nuclear interactions be due to the exchanges of massive particles with the pions and other mesons. But then if you looked at the effective field theory of those pions, you discovered that they had a chiral dynamics, and that chiral dynamics was a key clue to the formulation of QCD, because it told you that the interactions coupling quarks needed to be vector gluons, not scalar gluons. So effective field theories have played key roles in establishing the Standard Model. Maybe they'll play key roles in telling us what lies beyond the Standard Model. So we now develop something called the Standard Model effective field theory, where you assume that the Standard Model Lagrangian is correct. Everything written on the t-shirt is correct. It's just incomplete. And there's a large number of additional interactions, maybe too many to put on the t-shirt. Then you analyze in a global way the data from the Higgs boson, electroweak precision measurements, top quark data. And this framework, this global approach, I think is the most efficient way to extract the maximum amount of juice from the LHC and other measurements. And it provides you with a, well, not exactly model independent, but a somewhat model independent way to look for physics beyond the Standard Model. So, of course, there's an infinite number of high dimensional interactions. In fact, there's quite a lot of dimension six interactions. So when you do this, you typically make an approximation of neglecting higher order interactions, and you assume some sort of flavor symmetry amongst the fermionic higher dimensional interactions to simplify the analysis and make it manageable. So this is something that we and many others have been doing over the last few years. I would like to emphasize that this approach ties together many different sectors of our current Standard Model measurements. And you really have to look at these data in an integrated way in order to extract the maximum information from this Standard Model effective field theory approach. So for example, there's some operators that contribute to electroweak precision observables. They contribute to Higgs observables, top observables. You have to do a combined analysis of all those data in order to constrain those operators and their coefficients. And here I've already highlighted in red a particular subset of operators which could play a role in the mass of the W, something which I'll come back to in a moment. So we did this analysis a couple of years ago, And I'm not going to go into the details of it. Basically, we don't find any evidence that any of the coefficients of any of these operators is non-zero. And what instead you find is limits on the coefficients of these operators, which suggest that the heavy particles which mediate those interactions must have masses in the TeV range or beyond. So that was the picture before the measurement of the W mass by the CDF collaboration was announced. So here is a summary of the measurements of MW. So these blue measurements are the ones that were available before CDF, including a couple from LHC. And in gray here, we have the world average without CDF. Along comes CDF. CDF disagrees by 7 standard deviations with the predictions of the standard model, and by something like 4 standard deviations with the previous world average. So you can do a new global world average, although it's not so clear, you know, how meaningful that is given the discrepancy between the data. But Achal Grotu, sitting in the second row here, is an expert on this, so he can talk to that. Okay, so what could be explaining this discrepancy with the standard model? Well, if you do again this SMEFT analysis, you find that there are 4 operators which could go towards explaining the mass of the W without upsetting the other LHC and LEP measurements. So this is the result of a new global analysis where we include the high mass of the W, and any one of these 4 operators, 3 of which involve the Higgs boson, any of those could help reconcile the CDF measurement with the other precision electroweak measurements. Okay, but where do those operators come from? So one would suspect that those operators might be generated by some heavy particle. What heavy particle? So what you do is you can study all the extensions of the standard model with the addition of a single field. So some of them are spin zero, some of them are vector fields, and a lot of them are fermionic fields. And then you can ask, which of those single field extensions of the standard model could, in principle, make a contribution to the W mass? And it turns out there's relatively few of them which can contribute to the W mass with the appropriate sign. So a couple of them are vector fields, one is a scalar field, and there's a couple of fermionic fields. And then you can ask this global fit, what would be the masses and couplings of these extensions of the standard model, which could explain the W mass anomaly? And so typical values for the this vector boson around 3 TeV, for the scalar around 3 TeV, another vector boson, which would weigh about 8 TeV, and fermions, which would weigh somewhat in between. This is assuming that the couplings are unit. If the couplings are reduced compared to unity, then the masses are correspondingly reduced. So these then, I would suggest, are, you know, prime targets for searches at the LHC and future colliders to try to see whether any one of these indeed does explain the W mass anomaly. And already there've been results of the LHC which look for these particles. They're not sensitive enough yet to discover them, but for example, with high luminosity LHC, you would get into the range of masses that our SMEFT analysis suggests for at least some of these possible extensions of the standard model. So I think this provides a very specific motivation for looking for new particles with high luminosity LHC. Now, I mentioned, of course, the other big anomaly in, I'll come to that in just a second. You might be wondering whether, as I'm a fan of supersymmetry, aren't I going to say something about whether supersymmetry could explain the mass of the W? And the answer is, I don't really know. So there have been analyses of the possible contributions to MW of light supersymmetric particles and also of heavy supersymmetric particles, but there's been no, so far, global analysis of how supersymmetry could explain MW, and this is something which I'm working on at the moment. Now, looking forward, I think this SMEFT analysis is a useful way of organizing one's thinking about the possible sensitivities of experiments at future colliders. And there was extensive study of this type done by de Blas et al. As part of the formulation of the European strategy for particle physics. Again, this slide is too complicated to go through in any detail, but it tells you the precision with which you could constrain coefficients of these various different operators. And so gray is what we expect to be able to achieve with high luminosity LHC. And then you combine that with various future colliders and you finish up with FCC, which would give you the most precise measurements of these operator coefficients, as is shown by the fact that the blue lines here are consistently shorter than any of the others. FCC is the most precise tool that we could think of for studying possible interactions beyond the standard model. Okay, so how about this other anomaly, the anomaly in the anomalous magnetic moment of the muon? So I like very much this picture that was produced by the Fermilab publicity machine. I'm not quite sure whether it's showing the dawn of new physics due to G minus two, or whether it's the sunset of the standard model. But anyway, it's a beautiful picture. So supersymmetry and G minus two go back a long way. We wrote a paper about it 40 years ago. We weren't the only people, but there were other people who also wrote papers about supersymmetry at G minus two 40 years ago. That, of course, was long before the discrepancy with the standard model appeared. In the early 2000s, the first measurement from Brookhaven came in, showing a significant apparent discrepancy between the measurement and the standard model prediction. And this was, of course, supported last year in this new result from the Fermilab G minus two experiment. And the two measurements by Brookhaven and Fermilab agree very well. And the combined result is over four standard deviations different from the standard model prediction. Now, the story is a little bit more complicated than this. It's difficult to do an ab initio calculation within the standard model. And instead, what has been done predominantly until recently is to use other measurements as an input into formulating the theoretical calculation of G minus two. In particular, there's this diagram here, which involves the hadronic contribution to the photon vacuum polarization, which is difficult to calculate from first principles, but you can take it from data. This diagram here is related to this cross section, V plus E minus goes to hadrons. And this group of theorists reviewed all the available calculations of G minus two, and in particular, used this relationship as a key element in their theoretical prediction. And as you see here, the theoretical predictions, in particular the world average, which they favor, disagree significantly with the measurements by Fermilab and Brookhaven. Now, there are now attempts to do this calculation ab initio using calculations on the lattice. And these are what are shown in blue on the top here. They're not included in this world average calculation here. And in particular, there's been a lot of excitement about this calculation by the BMW group, which indicates a theoretical value which is much closer to the experimental value. And other lattice groups are now trying to reproduce their calculation. And it has to be said that several of them seem to be converging on a value close to what the BMW group found. If that were confirmed, then that would mean that if there is a discrepancy between theory and experiment for G minus two, it's smaller than we thought previously. But this discrepancy could be explained by supersymmetry. So here's a paper by Chakraborty and collaborators last year, where they showed that with a suitable light supersymmetric spectrum, you could explain the G minus two anomaly and also provide dark matter at the same time. The way that you do that is by having a smuon, the supersymmetric partner of the muon, which is relatively light, and arrange that its mass be only slightly larger than the mass of the dark matter particle, the neutralino. And these plots here are taken from the Atlas collaboration, and very kindly, they actually show you how you can explain G minus two with supersymmetric particles in this channel here with a compressed spectrum between the smuon and the neutralino, which has not yet been excluded experimentally. So this is certainly something for the LHC experiments, Atlas and CMS, to look at very carefully in the coming years to try to explore more thoroughly this compressed spectrum. Okay, so I guess I must be running out of time by this point. No? It's okay. So I just like to briefly discuss a couple of other topics beyond the standard model, showing how particle physics beyond the standard model could be related to fundamental cosmological issues. So one of them is the matter-antimatter asymmetry in the universe. So as Sakharov pointed out in 1967, CP violation in the laboratory combined with interactions that can create matter as appear even in the standard model, and the expansion of the universe could explain the asymmetry that we observe in the universe between the amounts of matter and antimatter. And the challenge ever since Sakharov has been trying to figure out some way of calculating the Baryon asymmetry of the universe using laboratory data. So I just wanted to mention a paper that we put out recently where we looked at this in the simplest possible extension of the standard model, where you just add in a single singlet scalar field. And you allow it to have an interaction which violates CP, so it goes beyond the Kobayashi-Maskawa model. And we imposed all the LEP and LHC constraints. So there are constraints coming, for example, from the signal strength and CP non-violation in the production of the top quark of the LHC. There are constraints coming from electroweak precision observables and from searches for new scalar bosons of the LHC. You put all these together, and here we have a set of parameter points as a function of the scalar particle mass and its mixing with the Higgs boson. And these orange points, these are the ones which give you a Baryon asymmetry within 10% of the experimental value. So you can explain the Baryon asymmetry of the universe in this appallingly simple model. And moreover, you do it with a relatively light scalar particle, which mixes with the Higgs boson in a way that it could be found at the LHC. finally, just a word about dark matter. So, you know, it's kind of an embarrassment that we can describe a few percent of the stuff in the universe, but most of it we can't, in particular dark matter, which should make up about 25% of the stuff in the universe. We can't explain that within the standard model. So of course it was Fritz Zwicky some 90 years ago who first postulated it from his observations of clusters of galaxies. And a key role was played by Vera Rubin in the 1970s, who observed the motions of stars in galaxies. She showed that they move too fast unless you postulate an additional gravitational field generated by invisible dark matter. And I think that it was Vera Rubin who really put dark matter on the map, on the consciousness of astrophysicists, cosmologists, and particle physicists. Somehow or other, the Nobel Prize Committee didn't quite see it that way. So basically, there's two sort of generic types of dark matter particle that people postulate: massive dark matter particles or ultra-light dark matter particles. So the lightest supersymmetric particle is sort of a prototype for this massive dark matter candidates. And the axion is a kind of a prototype for this ultra-light dark matter candidates. So this region of parameter space will be discussed by Oliver Buchmüller later on in the meeting when he discusses quantum sensors. And I just wanted to say a couple of words now about massive dark matter particles. So again, recently we did an analysis of the parameter space available in supersymmetry for providing dark matter. So we know the density of this dark matter with actually quite high precision, something like 1% precision. So it's not surprising that if you look in a supersymmetric model, the regions of parameter space that could provide the dark matter are not big cloud blobs. They're actually very narrow strips to get that 1% accuracy. And those strips extend out to very large supersymmetric particle masses beyond the reach of the LHC. Now, there are important constraints on the possible masses coming in particular from the measurement of the Higgs mass, which prevents you from going off to indefinitely large values. Now you can ask yourself, how are we going to find heavy supersymmetric particles? So clearly high luminosity LHC will be able to push the searches beyond what has been achieved so far. But the real best prospects for looking for massive supersymmetric particles of the type that could provide that dark matter are provided by FCC. And this again is taken from the European Strategy briefing book, and it shows you the reach of FCC Hadron-Hadron for looking for massive supersymmetric particles. There's a few examples. Gluino, for example, with a mass up to 17 TeV. And those dark matter strips could be explored by FCC HH. That brings me to the end of what I wanted to talk about. Here is my image of the current status of particle physics. So we have an iceberg, which has a small fraction of visible matter and a large fraction of as yet undiscovered dark matter. We have the standard model, which is doing fine, but maybe things won't be so great when it hits that iceberg. I don't know whether it's going to be sunk by Higgs physics, MW, G minus two, or dark matter, but I think we can be sure that dark matter will not live forever. Sorry, the standard model will not live forever. Thank you.
Let me thank Professor John Ellis for this such an excellent talk. And we have still some time, okay, for questions.
Yeah, so this question regarding the supersymmetry, actually, this is your slide. First time I have seen in 30 years that an anomaly cannot be explained by supersymmetry. In my whole life, any anomaly I have seen, next day, many paper came out to explain the SUSY, but it is not discovered yet. So how much we trust as an experimentalist supersymmetry anymore? Can you tell a little more on this?
So obviously, you know, we theorists, well, at least me theorists, are disappointed by the fact that we haven't seen supersymmetry so far. On the other hand, I think there's so many motivations for supersymmetry that, you know, it's a reasonable theory to continue to explore. And, you know, many other extensions of the standard model have been proposed, which to my mind have a lot less motivation.
That's agree, but my main objection in supersymmetry, as I said, last 30 years, any anomaly, immediately next day, supersymmetry said, yes, this is the solution for the anomaly. And next to next day, it disappeared. So that's my main objection on supersymmetry.
Oh, well, I think there's anomalies that no supersymmetrist ever claimed to be able to explain, but that's maybe something we could discuss.
Okay.
Yeah, regarding supersymmetry, if the scale of supersymmetry is somewhat high, as it seems to be indicated by the LHC, how are we going to reconcile this with the requirement of naturalness?
So it's certainly true that this would mean that supersymmetry by itself doesn't completely resolve the issue of naturalness. But still a hell of a lot better having supersymmetry at 1 TeV or 10 TeV than having no supersymmetry at all. So maybe that's telling us that it's only part of the answer. But I still think that naturalness provides a strong motivation for supersymmetry.
Yeah, I was continuing this comment from previous comment that we have not seen supersymmetry, but similar things has happened in Tevatron. Even though they produced 10,000 Higgs, we could never see it. But it was, if you look at the Higgs cross section, they produced plenty of Higgs in Tevatron. So it's possible that it's still there, but we have to still wait. And maybe we'll go for higher energy or maybe more luminosity, but it is produced, but we are not being able to see it. It's possible.
Okay, well, I personally don't believe that there's any evidence at the moment for in collider data for supersymmetry. But as I indicated, you know, there is at least one region of parameter space where supersymmetry could exist and it would be well within reach of experiments at the LHC. There is, in fact, another region, which I didn't have time to discuss, where you have a compressed stop spectrum, which is also accessible to the LHC. So that there certainly are no lampposts at the LHC which are as yet unexplored.
Yeah.
But I should say, I didn't want everybody just to focus on supersymmetry. I love supersymmetry, but you're not forced to love supersymmetry.
Yeah. So now continuing that one, I think recently with not finding supersymmetry it has gotten a lot of attention of LLPs. Can you comment on that experimental should now move on from specifically on the BSM sector, move on from supersymmetry to design some dedicated experiment on LLPs because we don't find supersymmetry anymore?
So I'm not quite sure that I understand
what I'm saying. The BSM physics point of view, should we as experimentalists focus on going to different experiments dedicated to different models such as LLPs and not look for a supersymmetry particles? Mm-hmm.
needless to say, there's many possible sources of long-lived particles in supersymmetry. I'm not going to go through the details of them. If you've got a very compressed spectrum, if you've got R parity violation at a low level, if you've got the gravitino as a light and supersymmetric particle, there's many different ways of getting long-lived particles. Personally, I'm not such a big fan of them, but no, thank you for mentioning them. I still like to hear from somebody who doesn't like supersymmetry.
May I ask?
Yeah.
So the results in the Smith operator when W anomaly, that the class of operators you choose and matching with the new W mass data. So are you taking any assumptions there? Like everything is positive in the Wilsonian coefficient, or you are mixing up the sign? Because depending upon those choices, we can end up in different direction altogether.
No, there was no assumption put in at the beginning. So I had these four operators that could modify the mass of the W. It actually turns out that one of them would modify in the wrong direction. Mm-hmm. So that one we then dropped. So there's actually only three of them that are actually generated by these single field extensions of the standard model that I discussed.
Yeah, but
positivity was not put in a priori, but it emerged a posteriori.
But like the region of the parameter, let's say in the Wilsonian coefficient, so those same parameter can come in other interaction coupling as well, right? Some of them at least. So the operators which are participating in the W mass modification can come also again other, let's say W and fermionic coupling or.
So those operators can come in other places, right?
Yes.
They could come in electroweak precision observables, yes. For example. And all that is taken into account in our analysis.
Oh, so everything is now taken.
So we do a global analysis, including all the available measurements from LEP and LHC.
Okay.
And that actually constrains some of the possible explanations of the W mass.
Okay.
So
thank you. A non-supersymmetric question.
Let us take two last questions.
Yeah.
One from Debaljyoti and then from Ravindran.
So this is about the G minus two. So as you pointed out, that if we take the BMW analysis, rather than the experimental way to calculate the thing, the discrepancy reduces. Now, would that not come back in other sectors? I mean, if I zero in on the BMW analysis, other measurements, would it affect other measurements?
So there is an issue of how you then reconcile the BMW calculation with the experimental data on E plus E minus, Mr. Hadrons.
Right.
And there's been some discussion as to whether the discrepancy arises above 1 GV in the E plus E minus center of mass or below 1 GV. If it arises above 1 GV, then you get into all sorts of problems with the high precision Z data, electroweak precision observables.
That's exactly what my question is.
Exactly. So I think that's, it seems to be very difficult to manage that tension. On the other hand, if you look at the data below 1 GV, it's very difficult to see how the experiments could have screwed up. Because you just mentioned it, measuring pion pair production. So in fact, just on Friday, we had a seminar at King's by Antonio Massiero, who has an explanation which sort of wiggles in between these two discrepancies, mm-hmm. Which involves some sort of new particle that couples to electrons, but not to muons, which could be mediated. Don't ask me more details. But I think you really have to work hard.
Okay. Right. Thanks.
So the last question.
Yeah. So you mentioned about MW anomaly from two experiments. Suppose you are not interested in explaining this anomaly. Which analysis you will take it most seriously, from LHC or from
Okay.
Teletron.
So the LHC measurements at the moment are much less accurate than the CDF measurement. Now, there are prospects for making more precise measurements at the LHC, and I think that both CMS and ATLAS see the importance of reducing their uncertainties to a level similar to that of CDF. But that will take some time. A lot of people are very eager, shall I say, to get some sort of confirmation of the CDF result, because it's an outlier. People have some questions about the way the analysis was done. I think the LHC experiments would do the analysis in a more complete way than was possible for CDF. We had a relatively small team working on the analysis. So no, I'm not saying that one should accept necessarily the CDF measurement at face value, but no, it's there, it's published, and if it's correct, it's very interesting.
Thank you.
I think that let us thank the speaker once again, and let us continue the discussion over coffee.